Good morning and welcome to Scottsdale Christian Church. Please stand and worship our Lord with us.
We haven't done this song in a while, but what a beautiful glimpse into heaven. Church, are we ready to seek for God as we start this week off? Yeah? All right, a couple of you are. Sing this with us, church.
Sing a song of celebration. Lift up a shout of praise, for the bridegroom will come. The glorious one. Song of the Lamb.
sing a new song to him who sits on heaven's mercy seat. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Holy, holy is he.
So much for this time that we are here in worship and in praise to you, God. You are holy, and there is nothing that measures up to who you are, and there is nothing that measures up to the love and mercy and grace that you give us in our Savior, Jesus Christ. May he be anointed this morning, God. May the hope and the encouragement and the love that we receive through our Savior, Jesus, be on our lips. May it be on our praise, Holy Spirit. May it be in Tom's message. May it be in the words we say and the things that we do and the message that we take into our heart today, God. There is nothing beyond your love. There is no thing in life or in death and everything in between that is beyond your care. So we lift this time up to you, God. May we be here in full worship and in praise of you and of all you give us through your Son and the mercy and love in Jesus Christ. It's in his name we are going to lift this praise up today, God. Amen.
Amen. Sing that with us.
And I will stand upon your truth.
All my days I'll live for you.
And all my days I'll live for you.
Stand upon your truth.
And I will stand upon your truth.
Yeah, all my days I'll live for you.
And all my days I'll live. Today is the day. I will rejoice and be glad in it. Today is the day you have made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. And I won't worry about tomorrow. I've given you my fears and sorrows. When you leave me, I will follow. Trusting in what you say. Today is the day.
Please be seated.
Good morning. We're going to be changing things up a little bit this morning. So, first of all, we want to know that you're here today. Whoops. Knock your worship pastor out. You have to lead the singing. Black book on the left side of your row there. If you just fill that out, we would really appreciate it. We'd love to know that you were here today. Also, in the front of the chairs, there's a praise card. If there's anything we could pray for you for today, we would just love to have that honor. So just fill that out and drop it in the bag as they pass it around here in a minute, or in the silver box in the back of the room. At this time, we are going to pray for our offering. Father God, we just thank you. We thank you for all that you do for us, for everything that you provide for us. We thank you for that in our personal lives, for our church, and for everybody around us. We thank you for this opportunity to show you our love back and our thankfulness for that. We ask that you bless this offering and give the leaders of our church the wisdom to spend it and use it in a way that builds your kingdom, that follows your plan, not ours. It's in your precious son's name we pray. Amen. Amen. Got a few things coming up to mark your calendars for. We've got the Dave Ramsey class starting on September 12th. You need to sign up for that. See Ray White. He's going to raise his hand and wave at you back there. No, he's not. Somebody point at him. Wave. There he is. Also, we got our walk coming up. There's several people that signed up. We still need to get that money in. If you're going to write a check to the church, just write it out to the church, or you can just drop some money in there, or get with me, and I'll show you how to do it online. We need about three to five more walkers. Also, we've got our picnic coming up in just 3 weeks. So we have got some sign-up sheets out in the lobby. We need your help. We need some people to help set it up. We need some people to help clean up. We need some games, things covered. We need you to bring some food. We're going to be providing all the hamburgers and hot dogs, but we need baked beans and potato salad and slaw and potato chips. So just sign up out there, however you can help us. We would really appreciate that. See Ray and Linda if you have any questions on that. And that's it on announcements. Today, we're starting a new series called A Series of Questions. And during that series, guess what I'm going to be doing? I'm going to answer your questions. Or try to, at least. If you hadn't put in your questions yet, there's still time. The more questions I have, the longer this series will last. It could go until next year if you have enough questions. No, I'm kidding. I'm grouping some of those questions together, but just fill out that piece of paper in your bulletin and drop it in the silver box back there, and I'll put them in the mix. Well, today, I've grouped some of these questions together. We had several questions about death. What happens to us when we die? Where do we go? Things like that. So I've grouped those kind of together today, and we're going to be looking at death and how Jesus affected that. When doing my research, I came across this video with some experts in it, and I was just going to use their information and make it look like I was really smart, but I decided to let them take the credit. So I just watched this video and see what these experts say.
When you die, people put you in a box and then put you in a special microwave.
What happens after we die?
Who dies?
You.
Oh. If they die, we come back to life.
You get reborn
to Earth
as
a different person,
as an animal.
An animal, a gorilla.
But you don't remember anything.
It's gonna keep happening again and again and again.
Do you know the word for that?
Teleport.
Reincarnation.
Yes.
Reincarnation.
If you could be reincarnated, what would you want?
I want to come as a warrior cat, a
dog,
fox,
zombie,
a nice big bird.
Well, I think we disappear.
But we're there in spirit.
What do you do as a spirit?
We go up into the sky.
We float like ghosts.
Ghosts.
What do you do as a ghost?
Go through stuff.
We can fight bad spirits.
Or we can be mummies,
zombies.
Or possibly just stay in the ground.
Our bodies rot.
And then the creatures eat us.
then our soul goes up to heaven.
For the rest of eternity?
You get to fly around with wings.
Who taught you that?
Jesus.
What do you think it's like in heaven?
Awesome!
I imagine that we lay on fluffy clouds.
And the big puffy clouds on the trampolines.
These are the clouds. They're nice and soft.
I don't know.
What happens after we die?
We go to heaven!
Just live a normal life where you're in heaven.
What kind of things go on in heaven?
You help people.
We get to see the people that are dead.
If I was up in heaven, I would go see my sister, my grandpa, and my cousin.
What happens when we die?
We go to heaven.
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 Heaven. We go to heaven.
Every single kid that said that.
Do you really believe that?
Maybe. I don't know.
What happens after we die?
We go to God,
where he lives. He lives in a tent.
God lives in a tent?
Mm-hmm.
Everybody goes to heaven.
Everyone?
No.
Jesus and God decide if we're going to heaven or
H-E-L-L.
You can say it.
Hell.
And what's hell like?
It's hot.
What happens after we die?
We stay dead. You die.
We get buried or burned.
Is there anything that happens after that?
You die. You're gone. So.
What happens to your actual body?
You start to get a little bit colder.
And you can't get up because you're dead.
Yes, that's true.
Well, I think it depends.
You can get burned up.
And then they throw us in the fire.
Or
they put you in a coffin.
In the graveyard.
Graveyard.
And get a crest. When our dad died, we wrote on balloons and we let them go to the sky.
But I wonder what it feels like for I to be dead.
I wonder what it feels like.
What happens after we die?
Everyone who dies will go into heaven, but their soul will still be remembered.
Experts have told you so. Go home. Have a great week. See you next Sunday. Don't get up. I was kidding. I have a good hour to talk about this today to go. So what about that video? There was a lot of kids talking about heaven. We saw that. But there was also some kids giving some other beliefs there as well, too. So what is the right answer? For me, and what I'm going to be talking about today, my answers come from the Bible. So that's where we're going to be going and looking for our answers today. What does the Bible tell us about death? Now, in your bulletin, there's a couple of things I want you to look at. First, there's a list of questions. These are some of your questions that you've asked, and I've kind of grouped them together, and that's the ones I'm going to be attempting to answer this morning. We're not going to go down this list, but these answers will be scattered throughout today's message, so just kind of be aware of that. And then if you open it up, there's kind of what I would call a timeline. And so we're going to be going through this timeline and talking about what happens when we die and how that's changed over the time. From the beginning of creation and how God's plan plays out all the way through Jesus' second coming and end times. So just kind of keep that handy, and we'll be going back and forth with that, if I can get my pages to separate. So what does the Bible say about death, about dying, and where we go? Now to do this, we had to piece it together. Nowhere in the Bible does it say, okay, there's the chapter on death, and it takes from the very first death of Adam and Eve all the way to the very end. We don't have a chapter like that in the Bible. So we have to go through, we have to kind of piece it together and see what fits here and what fits there, and are we talking about before Jesus, after Jesus, in between Jesus? And we put that all together, so just kind of bear with me this morning as we walk our way across this timeline. Let's start at the beginning. Can we show that picture of that timeline? So if we start at the beginning, by beginning I mean Old Testament. Anything prior to Jesus' death on the cross. That is what I'm calling Old Testament time. Well, during that, anybody that's under what we call the Old Covenant before Jesus, When people in the Old Testament, those who died before Jesus, died his earthly death, they went to a place called Hades. Hades is a Greek word meaning the abode of the dead. It doesn't mean a grave. It means where do our spirits go? Where do our souls go? And we're told that they go to Hades. So if you look at the timeline, that first section, I've blown it up there where you can see it a little easier. Now, there's something I want you to remember about this. This is a very simple illustration. Hades and God and creation is never as simple as a circle with a line through it. So just kind of keep that in mind. This is a very simple way to do it. Yeah, that's the word I was trying to say. So if you look at your timeline, that first section, what do we see? We see that Hades is made up of two parts. We see paradise and we see torment. Hades is not hell. A lot of people believe that Hades is hell. Hell, the actual lake of fire, is part of end times. It's where when God will create that and cast Satan and the fallen angels into the lake of fire. That happens when Jesus comes back. Right now, there's a place called torment. If you look at what does this mean and where do we get this information? Jesus gives us a glimpse of Hades in Luke 16. So if you want to turn to your Bibles to page 730, chapter 16, we're going to be reading there about a rich man, and Lazarus. There was a rich man who was dressed in purple and fine linen and lived in luxury every day. At his gate was laid a beggar named Lazarus, covered with sores and longing to eat what fell from the rich man's table. Even the dogs came and licked his sores. The time came when the beggar died, and the angels carried him to Abraham's side. The rich man also died and was buried. In Hades, where he was in torment, he looked up and saw Abraham far away with Lazarus by his side. So he called to him, "Father Abraham, have pity on me and send Lazarus to dip the tip of his finger into the water and cool my tongue, because I am in agony in this fire." But Abraham replied, "Son, remember that in your lifetime you received your good things while Lazarus received bad things. But now he is comforted here and you're in agony. And besides all this, between us and you is a great chasm has been set in place so that those who want to go from here to you cannot, nor can anyone cross from over from there to us." Now, if you look at this simple drawing, we see that Abraham, Lazarus, and the rich man are all in this place called Hades. We see the rich man is in a place called torment, inside of Hades. He looks up, that's why I have the drawing like this, and sees Lazarus and Abraham. Paradise, is also in some translations, is called Abraham's side or at Abraham's bosom. So we see that Lazarus is with Abraham. When Jesus is on the cross, he refers to paradise. He tells the thief that that's where he will be with him on that very day in Luke 23:43. Now, torment was not meant for us human beings. Hell is not meant for us human beings. It was designed for Satan and for the fallen angels. So when people say, "Why does God send people to hell?" He doesn't. We choose to go to hell. We choose by not following God and not following Jesus. It's our choice whether we go to torment or to paradise. Now, torment, Jesus talks about that too. In Matthew 25:41, he tells us that Then he will say to those on his left, depart from me, you who are cursed, into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and for fallen angels. So when he designed this, he didn't want us there. God does not want us to go to hell. God wants us in heaven with him. Jesus wants us in heaven with him. So let's talk about paradise for a minute. This is where Abraham is. This is where David was. This is where Esther, Jonah, Ruth, any of the believers that had faith in the Old Testament. Whether they were Jews or Gentiles. Remember, there was believers before there was Jews. Remember Noah? Even Abraham. It wasn't a country of Israel when Abraham was around. His descendants set up that country. So technically, Abraham is not a Jew either. But why are these people not in heaven? Why are they in paradise and not heaven? It's a good question. There's a simple answer. Sin. Nobody is without sin, even these Old Testament saints. Their sin had not been paid for yet. And to be in the presence of God, we had to be sinless. The time before Jesus, their sin had not been paid for. Their sin had not been atoned for. Because Jesus hadn't done it yet. But what about all the sacrifices that they did? The ones that God told them that they had to do? That's a good question. God set it up that way. He did it because he needed a system. He needed them to understand. But was these sacrifices enough to truly take care of their sin? Do you believe an animal, even the best of the best animal, is equivalent to Jesus? Do you think God puts any animal at the same level of his son? Yes, the sacrifices were important. God had a reason for setting them up. But what they did was delay payment for the sin. Not cover it up, not take care of it. Think of it like an interest-only loan. How many of us had an interest-only loan where all you have to do is pay the interest? If you pay the interest every year, they let you keep your house, they let you keep your car. You still owe the same amount. That principal never goes down. But as long as you pay this interest, you get to keep your house, you get to keep your car. Well, that's kind of what these sacrifices did. They took care of the now. Didn't take care of the forever. Jesus was the only one that could take care of sin completely. So at this time, before Jesus did that, they're in paradise. It's a good place. It's where they wanted to be. But they're still not in the presence of God because that sin still separates them. Now, there's another part of Hades that we want to talk about, too. So we talked about torment. We talked about paradise. We talked about that great chasm, that wall in between. Basically, once you die, game over. Once you die, your choice has already been made. Are you a follower of God? Do you believe in Jesus? Or do you believe you just die and go to nothing, as some of those kids told us. But what if they find out differently? Oh, there's no God. There's no heaven. But when they die, they find out, whoops, I made a mistake. I think I'll just run over to the other side now that I know that it really is a God. Can't do that. That doesn't happen. This barrier stops that from happening. Because who wouldn't run to the other side? We have to make our choices on faith and do that before we die. So here we have the Old Testament. Torment, paradise. We have all these great people like David and Abraham sitting in paradise, waiting for that day when they get to go and be with the Heavenly Father. Things change at the cross. Let's go back to the full view of that. Here we see there's going to be some changes, that blue line going up and down there. On the cross, Jesus paid the price for sin. All sin. Past sin, present sin, future sin. Hebrews 12:2 says, "Fixing our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of faith, for the joy set before him, he endured the cross, scorning his shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God." Jesus made it possible. The perfecter of faith made it possible for us to be in God's presence with him. He was the perfect sacrifice for sin. Remember those animals? No longer needed. Because if you don't have a debt, interest on nothing, nothing. Jesus paid your debt. Those debts that the Old Testament saints had sitting on their accounts, paid. That debt that we have sitting on our account, paid. Amen. Your great, 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 great grandkids, the sin that they're going to put on their debt, paid. Jesus paid for all sin on the cross on that day. So this changes where those saints, the ones from the past, the ones since Jesus died himself, it changes where they reside. Paradise is no longer needed. There's no longer a need for this separation. So today, we see a different set of things. We see Jesus, when he was hanging on the cross, he gave us some clues to what was going to happen. Now, one of the questions somebody asked was, did Jesus have to go to hell to pay for our sins? No. He did not go to physical hell to pay for our sins. When he was hanging on the cross, dying for the sins of the world, I can't even imagine what that is even like. But he endured it. He took it and he survived it. He did not have to go to physical hell because he took all that pain, all the sacrifice that was needed was him alone while he hung on the cross. He received all of that pain, all of that suffering for our sins while he was hanging there before he died, before he took that final breath. He received the punishment of all the sin of all the world. And how do we know that? Because right before, towards the end, what does he say? It is finished. At that point, Jesus is still alive. And he's telling us, it is finished. Payment for sin is done. I've done it. If we look at John 19, verses 28 through 30, we see this. Later, while he was hanging on the cross, knowing that everything had been finished, and so that Scripture would be fulfilled, Jesus said, "I am thirsty." A jar of wine vinegar was there, so they soaked a sponge in it, put the sponge on a stalk, and lifted it up to Jesus' lips. When he'd received the drink, Jesus said, "It is finished. Sin has been paid for. It is finished." With that, he bowed his head, and he gave up his spirit. This is where the change of what happens to us when we die takes place. When he bowed his head and he gave up his spirit, Jesus' spirit left his body. Just like our spirit and our soul leaves our bodies when we die. But where did he go? That was one of the questions. Where did he go for these 3 days from the time he died and the time that he was resurrected? There's not a lot on that. But there is a little bit. We get a few clues. One of those is from Jesus himself before he dies. If you look at Luke 23, verses 42, 43, he's hanging there with the thief. The other thief is mocking him, and this thief realizes, oh no, I'm in trouble. This guy might really be who he says he is. So he looks at Jesus, and he says, Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. I acknowledge who you are. Forgive me. Jesus answered him with, truly I tell you, today, the day that you die and the day that I die, you will be with me in paradise. Here we see the thief acknowledge who Jesus was. And he asked for forgiveness. And he was told that he would be rewarded with paradise. He would be in the presence of Jesus that very day because of his faith and his confession. He would get to spend eternity in heaven. And we see that Jesus is getting ready to head there himself because he says, I will see you there in paradise today. So Jesus has now took his last breath and he's off to paradise. Teleporting. That's what the kids said. I think we're going to get to teleport. I think that's just kind of neat. So he's off to paradise. What does he do while he's there? It's time to make some changes, he says. He's going to shake it up a little bit. But what are those changes? What is he going to change now that he's there? What has changed from the day before? The big thing, sin has been paid for now. Those saints, their sin debt has been paid. There's no need for them to be separated from God. He has some good news for these guys in paradise, right? Ephesians 4, verses 7 through 10 tells us a little about what he does. But to each one of us, grace has been given as Christ appropriated it. This is why it says, when he ascended on high, he took many captives and gave gifts to his people. What does he ascend mean, except that he also descended to the lower earthly regions? He who descended is the very one who ascended higher than all the heavens in order to fill the whole universe. The captives, that's those saints. What's that gift? He's taking them home. They get to be in the presence of God now. It says he ascended. Where is Hades? It's vague, but it seems like maybe it's inside Earth at the core. I don't think it's something we can dig down to and find, just like we can't go flying high and see heaven. It's somewhere we can't go as living human beings and can't find. Because if we could see it, why would we need faith? In other words, when Jesus gets to paradise, what does he do? He gets excited. Can't you imagine? All this stuff has been building up to this moment. And now there he is in paradise, and he's got this amazing thing. So he says, there's my granddaddy David. Come on, David. Come on, Daniel. We got things to do. We're going home. I got somebody I want you to meet, your Heavenly Father. And he takes them to heaven. When he ascended on high, he took many captives and gave gifts to his people. We also know that while he was in Hades, he made some proclamations. He preached. Don't know exactly what those proclamations was or what he preached about. But I can imagine he was proclaiming his victory over sin. I told you it was going to happen. You knew it. It's been prophesied. The day is here. Today, I have beat sin and paid the price. So now if you look at our timeline, you'll see that paradise has now moved. That's heaven. Remember, in Hebrews 12:12, he says, he sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Well, where is the throne of God? It tells us that we'll be in the presence with Jesus when we die, after he dies on the cross. Well, where is Jesus? He's at the throne of God. So that's where we will be, with Jesus in heaven with God. Second Corinthians tells us in 5:8 that if we're away from our bodies, if we're dead, our soul has left us, and if we have lived by faith, that our souls are at home with the Lord. And here we see that he is at the right hand of the Father. But what about those that don't believe? Where do they go? Well, at this time, the day that we're living now, because we are living in between Jesus' earthly trips, they continue to go to torment. They continue to be separated by that great divider to wait their judgment, to find out what hell is going to be like for eternity. Because no one, even now, cannot cross over that barrier. Once we make that choice, once we die, the choice is made. We either go to heaven to be in the presence of Jesus, or we go to Hades in the torment side. This is where we're at today. If I die, if you die, this is what the picture looks like. We get to go to heaven. Our loved ones, they're in heaven looking down on us. Makes us feel good to think about that. They're in the presence of God. They're in the presence of Jesus. We get to be part of that when we die. But the timeline isn't finished yet. There's still another part. We're not going to spend a lot of time on that this morning, but as we look at this next picture, we see when Jesus returns for the second time. This will be the final judgment. This will be when everything changes that fits into God's perfect plan. Hebrews 9:27 says, just as people are destined to die once and after that to face judgment. This is that judgment, which takes us back to what Jesus said in Matthew 25. When the Son of Man comes in his glory and all the angels with him, he will sit on his glorious throne. All the nations will be gathered before him, and he will separate the people one from another as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goat. He puts the goats on his right and the sheep on his right and the goats on his left. Then he will say to those on his left, depart from me, you are cursed, into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. Then Revelation 21 tells us what that new change is going to all be about. What's it going to look like? The believers, the saints, this is what we have to look forward to. If you look at Revelation 21, starting with verse 1, then I saw a new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and there was no longer any sea. I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of the heaven from God, prepared as a bride, beautifully dressed for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, look, God's dwelling place is now among the people, and he will dwell with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God. He will wipe every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death or mourning or crying or pain, for the old order of things has passed away. And then in Revelation 22, we see where Eden is restored. Then the angel showed me the river of water of life, as clear as crystal, flowing from the throne of God and of the Lamb. Down the middle of the great street of the city, on each side of the river stood the tree of life, bearing 12 crops of fruit, yielding its fruit every month, and the leaves of the tree for the healing of the nations. No longer will there be any curse. The throne of God and the Lamb will be in the city, and his servants will serve him. They will see his face, and his name will be on their foreheads. There will be no more night. There will be no need the light of a lamp or the light of the sun, for the Lord God will give them light, and they will reign forever and forever. This will be our. This will be the saints. This will be for the believers, the Christians. This will be our eternal home. What John describes in Revelation. This is also the time of that final judgment for those in torment. They will be cast into the lake of fire. They'll be cast into hell for eternity. Remember, it's by their choices, not God's. And they will end up in a place designed not for us, but for Satan and the fallen angels. So how do we make sure that we get to be in heaven? How do we make sure that we're in the presence of Jesus and God for eternity? There's only one way. And there's two big hints to what that is right here on the side of these stages. John 14:6. Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." He doesn't leave much wiggle room there. No one comes to the Father except through me. But how do we do that? Well, Jesus, he don't make it a secret. He tells us in John verses 3 through 7, "Truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God." Nicodemus said to him, "How can a man be born when he is old? Can he enter a second time into his mother's womb and be born?" Jesus answered, "Truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born of water and the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. That which is born of flesh is flesh, and that which is born of spirit is spirit. Do not marvel that I said to you, you must be born again." In other words, we have to believe Jesus is who he says he is. We have to accept what he did for us on the cross, and that means so much to us. We have to accept that gift, and we have to open it up. We have to repent from our sin, turn away from our sinful ways, and turn towards God's way. We have to be baptized, and we have to receive the Holy Spirit. Jesus gives us the outline of how to have eternal life. He tells us that he is the way to the Father. So this morning, as we close this out this morning, I just ask you to ask yourself, where am I going to be? What place has my choices directing me right now? Will I be with the Father or not? Let us pray. Father God, we thank you for having a plan. We thank you for giving us the opportunity to be a part of that plan. We thank you for loving us enough that you sent your Son to die for the things and to pay for the things that we did. The things that we know are wrong, and yet we continue to do them. Father God, we thank you for Jesus. We thank you for him being the sacrifice
that gets us into heaven. And Jesus, boy, could not have a better big brother than that. Thank you from the bottom of our hearts for being the way, the truth, and the life. So this morning, I just ask that everyone in this room examines their heart, examines their choices, and makes the right ones so that we can spend eternity together as a family, as believers, as Christians, as children of God. We thank you, and it's in your precious Son's name we pray. Amen.
Your unfailing love, O Lord, is as vast as the heavens. Your faithfulness reaches beyond the clouds.
I will remember the deeds of the Lord. Yes, I will remember your miracles of long ago.
I will meditate on all of your works and consider all your mighty deeds.
And he
took bread, gave thanks and broke it, and gave it to them, saying, "This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me."
In the same way, after the supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you.
I will remember the deeds of the Lord. Yes, I will remember your miracles of long ago. I will meditate on all your works and consider all your mighty deeds.
All the ends of the earth will remember and turn to the Lord, and all the families of the nations will bow down before him.
May your unfailing love rest upon us, O Lord, even as we put our hope in you. Let your unfailing love surround us, Lord, for our hope is in you alone.
Good morning. I think that video pretty much says it all. Jesus, I was reading to Matthew, and all the miracles he's done, and ultimately paying the ultimate price for sacrificing himself. Driving in this morning, I really don't know what to say for this, but I think we heard a song by Hillsong, and I think it just sums it up perfectly. Just Jesus, what a beautiful, wonderful, and powerful name it is. So this time in the service, we're going to do communion. Chairs will be passed. Please take a cup and a cracker representing the blood and body of Christ. Let us pray. God, Jesus, just be with us as we reflect and remember everything you did for us. Help us grow, and helping us grow and understand the meaning of your life and what it means in our life. And just be with us as we go wherever you want us to go and go do what you want us to do. Help us share this word and this message with everybody that we feel needs it, and let us do it in love and be with everybody and just love everybody with all this hardship and bad stuff that's going on in this world. Just let us live the way you want us to live and make the right choices the way you would want us to make those choices. In your name we pray, amen.
Love to thank you for joining us this morning. If you're new here, we glad you chose us this morning. We are honored. If you're watching this online, we hope that you say hi to us. Let us know you're out there. Whatever it is this morning that may be weighing on your heart, let us lift it up to Jesus with you. Let us lift it up to God with you. He's a loving Father that loves us and wants the very, very best for us. And he gives us people to surround us, to give us that love and to show us that love. Let's be that for each other. If anybody wants to talk about their relationship with God, I'll be out here in the lobby. I'll be glad to have that discussion with you, or any of the elders will, or Everett or anybody else. Also, somebody's waving a prayer card at me. Oh, I did earlier. Oh, yeah. So if you have a prayer request, fill that out, put it in the back silver box back there. I think we need to, we're kind of heavy. That was a heavy sermon. So let's lift it back up. I want to ask everybody to come back. That first song, that lively song, they got everybody going. You're going to sing that again. Let's go out and let's praise God and let's celebrate.
Let's sing this out to God. Let's sing this out to you too, Corey.
Sing a song of celebration. Lift up a shout of praise for the bridegroom who comes, the glorious one. To a much better place. Dance with all your might. Lift up your hands and clap for joy, for the time's drawing near, and He will appear. And stand by His side, a strong, yet spotless bride. We will dance on the streets that are gold, a glorious bride and a great Son of Man. Every tongue and tribe. The song of the Lamb.
Sing that again, church, from the top.
Sing a song of celebration. Lift up a shout of praise, for the bridegroom will come, the glorious one. Much better place. Dance with all your might. Lift up your hands and clap for joy, for the time's drawing near, when He will appear. And oh, we will stand. song of love. We will dance, we will dance.
Hallelujah, church!
We hope you all have a great week, and we'll see you next week in 15 minutes for the Bible study.
We bring